Oh, we have in Jesus. I know we all know that we have friends, but there's never ever going to be a friend like Jesus. For he's closer than a brother. And you can tell any secret you want to tell, and you won't get out. But the song says, what a friend we have in Jesus. All our sin and grief to bear. If you know the song, help us sing.
Thank you. I just kind of like talking a little bit, so I just want to share a few things with you. Lord, for this men's day that you've given us, that you've allowed the men, this church, to come together, to worship together, to stand before your people, and to talk about, Lord, who we are, who you want us to be. We pray and we thank you now for the presence of your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, I'm going to ask one favor from men and you as a church, if it's all right. I really don't feel that comfortable up here. So if y'all don't mind, I don't know, on the floor, thank you. I appreciate it. See, for one thing, I'm short.
It's hard to see y'all on that big pulpit. And
I just enjoy life. I woke up this morning, my house wasn't under a flood.
Amen.
With no bullet holes, with no through the wall. Did you hear about the little boy? A bullet just missed his head while he was sleeping in bed the other night. My wife, man, came home okay. I didn't worry about her. She was in attack, raped by militias trying to steal her. You know what I'm saying? There are things that we experience in this country. I know it's bad. I know there is a lot going on in our country. But Lord have mercy. You and I are not dealing with a quarter, a tenth. Would you believe a fifth of some of the issues that some people are dealing with in other countries? We're not even dealing with some of the situations some people are dealing with in other states. I know you were awake watching TV with me last Thursday night. I was so happy. My manager said, Ed, we're going to close the office tomorrow, so you don't have to come in Friday. So you might have been like me, sitting there, you know, watching TV, watching the hurricane, see what was going to happen. And the Lord blessed the Jacksonville area. We got a little wind, a little rain. Some of us was out of power for a little while. But way further west, all the damage that took place. So I don't know about you, but I'm happy. Now, I'm sad to them, but I have to thank God for how you did to me. So I hope somebody's happy today.
Amen.
If you're not happy today, that's all right. I understand, because I am. I think Brother Barnes, the deacon, and elder, somebody's going to be happy with me today. Is that all right?
Amen.
All right. The brother sang this morning. Did y'all hear them sing?
Amen.
Send me a man. Our scripture text, our scripture reading is taken from Isaiah chapter 6, verse 8. The Bible says, "And I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send? And who will go for us? And I said, here am I. Send me." Now, the New Living Translation kind of says it the same way, but says it just a little different. It says, "Whom then I heard the Lord asking, whom should I send as a messenger to this people? Whom shall I send as a messenger?" Oh man, that got a bad technology department. See, I didn't usually create my own PowerPoints and bring them, but I wasn't sure, you know. So I, man, y'all, thank you. Amen. So in the New Living Translation, it says, "Whom should I send as a messenger to the people?" So the question is a little more specific. It's not just who am I going to send, but who am I going to send as a messenger to my people? And then it says, "Who will go for us?"
Right.
And I said, "Lord, I will go. Send me." So, brothers, I want to talk to you about your call. The Bible asks, "Who's going to go?" God says, "Send me a man." And oftentimes we wait or feel as though we have to have some type of special urge or some type of special feeling in order to do something for God. Well, right here in Isaiah, there was no specific call. God didn't say, "Hey, said, I want you to go and witness to the people for me. God was looking for somebody to do something for him. And he said, who will he send? Who will be a messenger for me to teach people about me? See, the problem we have in the world today, you know, we want to blame it on the world. The problem is not the world. The problem is us. Now, please say with me. When I say us, I'm not talking about all of us. I'm talking about some of us. Now, see, there are some of us who proclaim and talk and claim that we are children of God. See, there are some of us who will come and sit up in this church every week and we'll talk about how much God is love and how powerful God is and all praise the name of Jesus and what God can do for you in your life and how he can deliver you and how he can protect you, and we'll strut our stuff through the course of the Sabbath day and we'll talk about and pretend like that. Oh, did I say pretend? We'll talk about there is a God. But then when life hits, when situations happen, when causes cry out for someone to show that there is a God, where are you and I? Now, sisters, I'm talking to the men today, okay? So y'all, right? I know y'all know what y'all need to do. And brothers, I'm washing my clothes in this laundry as well. Because see, this is more, much more to being a man and being a Christian than holding a title in the church.
But being cut too.
You might try to pretend like we don't put each other down. We're not jealous of each other. But see, part of the problem in being men is sometimes we don't support each other enough. We're too busy being jealous of each other. We ain't gonna show. I'm not gonna show that I'm jealous of you. But brother, trust me, I am. You may not know that I'm envious of you and what you got and what you're doing and how you're doing it, but I am. And David had to deal with that stuff before he went out to fight Goliath. So now I tell you what, do me a favor. Go to 1 Kings. Go to chapter 15. Let me just, I'm going to give you the scripture text when you can read them all when you get home. But let me show you how David wound up on the scene, how the man God needed showed up. First of all, in 1 Kings chapter 15, verse 9, in the New Living Translation, it says, Saul and his men spared Agag's life and kept the best of the sheep and the goats and the cattle and the fat calves and the lambs, everything, in fact, that appealed to them. They destroyed only what was worthless or of poor quality. I don't know if you're familiar with the story, but God sent Saul on a mission to destroy and wipe out a nation God had spared for years and years, giving them a chance to get their act together. God finally said, enough is enough, Saul, here's what I want you to do. I want you to go in, it's in chapter 15, verse 10, I want you to wipe out everybody, kill everything. And Saul was king. And God said, this is what I want you to do. Sometimes as men, when God has called us to do something, if we don't do everything God has called us to do, we cannot expect to continue on in the role that He given us.
That's right.
I'm talking to the men now. And the young men. See, God called Saul and asked him to do a certain thing. But what Saul did, what a lot of us do as brothers, we compromise and make excuses for not doing everything that God wants us to do because it just doesn't feel as if it's not going to allow him. Well, let's just go to verse 17 and 18. It says, and Samuel told him, because see, when Samuel caught up with Saul, he said, well, and you know, I did what you told me to do, and you know, it was because of the people that I didn't do it. We took the best, we kept the best lambs, we kept the best sheep. But that's not what God said. He said, kill everything. And sometimes as men, we feel as though I got to do it the way I want to do it. Are y'all know this is quiet, isn't it? I'm just checking you. Listen, okay, I'm just checking. I'll see. You know how I like interacting with people. Thank you. Okay, I'm sorry, say this. You're taking notes? Okay, all right. I'm just saying, listen, now, I don't know if y'all know, but if you at least say amen sometime, I know you're not asleep. And I promise you, I'm not going to be long. I just want to drive home a couple points, because I know y'all got things you have to do. But do you hear what I'm saying? See, as men, when God calls us to be and to do, we can't half step on it and expect and think God is going to be pleased. I don't know about you, my brothers, but I have spent a lot of time in my life not doing everything I knew God wanted me to do. It looked right, it felt right, I thought it was okay, it was partial obedience, so you know, I think a little bit was enough, but it's not. And then, when God sends someone our way, because here's the thing, God will always send somebody your way.
Yes, sir.
Samuel loved Saul. He loved him. He anointed him. He was willing to be with him. You ever had a friend? They really wasn't, I won't say they were you know, they were struggling when they were growing up. And through life, you know, they got their act together, things started going good for them, they started excelling and achieving, you know, you're happy for them, and then they kind of got beside themselves, you know, they kind of forgot where they came from. You ever had that happen to some people you hang out with? But it always seems like God has somebody in your life to keep you grounded. But what happens is we don't want to listen to that person that wants to keep us grounded. And when they tell us the truth about ourselves, we've gotten so caught up in life, you know, as men, you know, we achieve, we fight hard, we work hard, we do, we excel. things happen. And then I, who are you going to tell me what I should do at this point stage in my life? You knew me when. Now I'm here. Well, you know the rest of the story. Samuel told us all this. God's got somebody else. Somebody else who's going to take your place. You know, that's a hard thing to hear. Let me kind of put a little humanism to Saul. See, I think we're a little cold on Bible characters sometimes. You know, we read the Bible, we read it's like pages, just words out of a book. But these were real people. Can you imagine after being king of Israel all these years, having all these victories, coming from nothing to becoming the first king of one of those powerful nations in the then known world, for the man who anointed you to tell you, that's it. It's over. It's like going to work and somebody telling you you're going to get fired, but they're not telling you when. It's like your husband said, baby, I'm leaving, but he ain't got his bag left to leave the house. And so now Saul is living with this idea, this fact that he will no longer be king. But see, God needed somebody at the time who was going to represent him, who was going to live with him, who was going to do what needed to be done. God needed a real man. See, here's the other thing, ladies. There's a misconception of what a real man is. Fellas, same thing for us sometimes. See, if I brought the Rock, I don't even call himself the Rock that morning. But if I brought the Rock, you know who the Rock is, right? Wayne Hamilton, plays it on the movies, on the first time. Johnson, Dwayne Johnson, see, I didn't know that's the Rock. See, now, if I would bring Dwayne Johnson out here, that's real, man. You know what I'm saying? That's what we, you know, real man is tall, built, handsome, physically strong, athletic, maybe well-dressed, drives a Jag, makes six figures, I ain't nothing wrong with it, sister. No, that ain't nothing wrong with it at all. But see, we bought into thinking that's a real man. And even as men, when we see men who may have a lot of physical, strong characteristics as we consider them, or a lot of material things, we think that is a man, and that's what being manly is. And we bought into society and we bought into the culture that being a man means how much can I get, how much do I have? So now when we go to school, now when we pursue careers, it's not like it was back in the day when we pursued careers to try to help each other, to try to lift each other up, to try to make life better for one another. Now when we pursue careers just to do for me. But I'm being a man. It was a time being a man that taking care of everybody in your family. Looking out for everybody in your family. Not just your immediate family, your nephews, your nieces, your cousins, your aunt, your uncle. Like, we don't have time for that right now. There used to be a time of being a man that, well, you know, I'm out of school over here, right? To the gents, to the gentlemen. How much time do we, and I have to say we, because you know it's a sad thing, this is a quick sidebar, only got a few more minutes. Did you know it's a shame, especially in an African-American Seventh-day Adventist community? We'll have a church in our, we'll have a school in our city. We'll have one speaker. Whatever church the school is closest to, we automatically see that school as belonging to that church.
Mercy. Mercy.
It's my school too. But sadly.
Mercy.
Sadly, I could be wrong. You know, maybe because I've only been living in Jacksonville a few years. But sadly, we don't promote it as everybody's school. Mm. because everybody not get your attention. We don't promote it as everybody's school. How dare we have to let somebody get up and ask for a box of paper for the school?
Compromise on working on Sabbath to make an extra dollar.
God says, I need somebody like that. So he sent Samuel to Jesse. Now, when Samuel got to the village, folks were a little scared. They said, everything all right? Now, see, Samuel just hacked the king to death, you know. So they were a little scared. They didn't know what Samuel was coming to do. Samuel said, everything's good. And Jesse, I want you to get your sons. And Jesse brought his son before him. And you know, and Samuel was like us. You know, when you know the story of Samuel, when he brought the first son by, Samuel said, oh Lord, this must be the one. Tall, strong, handsome. And the Bible said, the Lord told Samuel, look, I'll look at the heart. He says, excuse me, I'm glad I'm here for a second. You know why some of us are not where we want to be? Because God has looked at our hearts. And he knows the way we are.
Yep.
And since he's looked at our hearts and he knows the way we are, he can't do for us what he wants to do for us. He can't put us where he wants to put us. He can't give us where he wants to give us because he knows our heart. And so no matter how I might parade or how I might act, God knows my heart. So if you're wondering why you didn't get that promotion, God knows your heart. You're wondering why things aren't going the way you think they should go right now because God knows your heart. You wonder why you didn't get that job and somebody else did because God knows your heart. You wonder how come you didn't get that sister and somebody else did because God knows your heart. He was going to let you mess up her life. He was going to get hurt right there. I thought I'd throw that one in. But sometimes you don't understand, man. See, God loves us so much, he will protect us and even in our relationships. And that one that sister thought she should get, she didn't know why it didn't work out. She really prayed about it and hoping with it. God was like, no, baby, I love you too much to let you get stuck again.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
So each of the sons came by and they come by and they look and they see. And so then, after it's over, Samuel said, listen, you got somebody else? Now, fellas, this is how people think of us sometimes. So you might not be important in your family, you might not be important in your church. For my young brothers, you might think you're not important in your school. You may think nobody pays attention to you. Because the job that you have or what you do is not the thing that people consider important. Being on the chess team is not as elaborate as being on the football team. Being on the spelling team is not as elaborate as playing basketball or running track. Being a part of the science class is not as elaborate as being on the wrestling team. But if that's what you are good at, be the best at it. Don't let people make you think you gotta play football, you gotta play basketball, you gotta wrestle, you gotta do this, you gotta. You just gotta be the best at who you are and whatever you are. And that's the kind of God man God is looking for. He needs somebody who is doing the best at whatever they're doing. David was not embarrassed to be a shepherd, even though his father and his brothers didn't think that much of him. And sometimes we don't come to the dinner, we don't bring what we have to the table, we don't offer what we have because we think it's not important. People don't see me as important. People don't think of me, they don't believe, they don't. Just me. Just you. I don't look like them. I don't dress like them. I don't live where they live. I don't talk like them. God can't use me. Church don't think I'm important. I split my verbs too much. I walk with a limp. Sometimes my pants a little higher than my shoes. I don't have the education some people have. I got a minimum wage job. I don't have a big time job, but I don't have any letters behind my name. I drive a hoopty. I got to get in from the right hand side or get over to the left hand side to drive. And we look at people like that. And we think there's no way they can be a benefit, they can do a service to us, or as a man, because I don't have all the things some other men may have. I don't have anything to offer. But the Bible says that God said, that's the one said. Yes. And David didn't even know what was going on, but The spirit will change, Mike, but your social status might not change right away. David was still shoveling. So this prosperity preaching that people do, see, even after David was anointed, he's going back to the sheep. Now then, when we jump into 1 Samuel chapter 16, you read about how the Bible says this evil spirit was coming upon Saul. And so then they say, hey, Saul, listen, you know somebody? Let's go get him, let him play for you. See, now what God will do for us as men, he will put you in the positions you need to be in. You don't have to politic for him. Because a lot of times we think we got to maneuver and manipulate and be slick in order to get somewhere. No, you don't. You just got to be true to your call. You just got to be true to you. If you are good at what you do and if you are the best at what you do, somebody will recognize what you do. And not only will they recognize it, they will recognize it, they will call you, and God will place you.
Yes, sir.
So David goes from being a shepherd to being Saul's court.
Yes.
See, God sets up situations and circumstances in order for you and I to learn.
Yes.
All right.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Can I get the piano there? Keyboard is my brother, if you're around. Okay. So I had to give you back. So now, go with me to 1 Samuel chapter 17. So now let's get there. See, as men, we never know when and where God is going to call us. But if we're faithful in whatever it is he asks us to do at any given point in time in our lives, God will exalt us. See, here's the question. Are you going to be ready when the call comes? And what is the call that you really answer? See, all these years, I thought the battle was between David and Goliath.
Should do, what a brother should do, but
It wasn't anything easy about the way David did. Saul's army on this side of the valley. The Philistines on this side. Goliath and his armor bearer in front of him. But it's all about God. See, when you and I stop living for ourselves as men, and we decide we are going to live for God, God will do wonderful, miraculous things in our lives because I can't save you. I don't have the power to change anybody. Mm-hmm. But my God can do anything.
Yes, he can.
He needs someone to work through, to show that he can do anything. So you got that drinking problem? God can heal it. You got a gambling problem? God can take care of it. You looking for a job? God can give you one. Your marriage shaky? God can fix it. But you gotta be willing to trust and give your all to him. So when Goliath called out, send me a man. You gotta be you. You don't have to be anybody else. Don't try to be, David tried being like Saul, putting on his armor. It didn't work. Say, so man, no, I'm sorry. Let me just take my rocks. Let me just get my sling. People gonna say you crazy, but you be you. And David went out there, and now correct me if I'm wrong, but I don't read anywhere in the Bible. You're in the Bible now, I don't read. Where God said, David, I want you to go out and slay Goliath. And David, this is how you're going to do it. You're going to go out, you're going to grab 5 smooth stones from a brook, and then you're going to run toward him, and then you're going to throw the stone, and Goliath is going to fall. Anybody read that? Anybody read that? In the book of 1 Samuel, anybody read that? No. But I have read somewhere, God gives opportunity. Success depends on what we make of it.
Yes.
So David said, hey, I'm going to honor God. And not only am I going to honor God, I'm going to give it a brand new wife. My daddy ain't going to have to pay taxes anymore. I'm going to live good. There's something about doing for God. I don't know what it is, but he takes care of you. So then what David did, he said, I'm going to do this thing. He said, I defy you. You're talking about what you're going to do. I'm going to tell you what God is going to do for me. So David went down and he picked up those rocks. And one commentator said, those rocks were like small cannons. And wait a minute now. Here's the best part. I didn't know. Israelites were trained to sling.
Yes.
And they were trained so well, they would put loaves of bread on poles. So if the shepherd wanted to eat, he had to learn how to knock that bread off that pole. So when God called this man, he was good at slinging. And so what he did, he was small. He could move. And oh Lord, I wish I could have been there to watch it.
Yes, sir.
Because I'm sure David didn't walk. I'm sure he ran from side to side as he moved toward Goliath. And as he was moving, he was swinging. And as he was going, and he let that stone go. One commentator said the ball, those rocks move at 100 miles per hour.
Yes, sir.
Goliath coming after him, raised up his helmet. See, when you give everything you got to God, and you go after your Goliaths, he'll take care of us.
Yes.
But see, that's not the end of the story. See, as men, we got to learn how to finish strong.
Yes, sir.
A lot of times, we have habits of starting stuff and not finishing. You know what I'm saying? Getting a marriage relationship is good when you start. She needs a little more than what you was giving when y'all first had together. You know what I'm saying? But we think all we got to do is keep doing what we know. You got to finish the job. So you know what he did, my brother? He doesn't feel like life. I got to go around with him. You know what he did? He hit him with the rock. And the light fell. Then he took the light's sword. And then he cut his heel. completed the job. He completed his task. And as men, that's what we have to do. In this generation, now, we have to finish the task. There's so much to do. We ain't made it to the promised land yet. I don't care how good your job is.
Thank you. may the God of peace who raised Christ from the dead strengthen your inner being for every good work. And may the blessing of God Almighty, all of Son and Holy Ghost, rest upon you and dwell within you this day and evermore. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God for whom all blessings flow.